Hello to everybody. We are here to present work we are doing, and this work is about an underwater movie. We had a chance to work with this movie maker, this talented documentarist, who has been making underwater movies and documentaries all over the world. So he filmed all the kind of fishes, like sharks, like I don't know English names, so better stop to sharks. And he started to talking with us. He started to develop the idea of making a movie in which there were also artificial fishes. So fishes acting with the real environment or the real actors. So we can start with the PowerPoint. So okay, the title of this movie is A Fabulous Sea. From now it's developed in Italian, so Italian name is Un Mare da Favola. And you can go on. It's the original concept was a short tale for children. So he has made many short movies regarding relationship between children and the sea. So these movies had some kind of not just nice images, but also some kind of educational intent. So one of the main things that we wanted to do was totally an underwater environment. This means that all the scenes filmed were filmed underwater, and underwater not in a pool, but underwater in the real places where it should happen. So you know that usually when Hollywood movies have some underwater scenes, they are not in the sea, real sea, but they are in special pools with cameras and everything perfect, lightning and faked waves, all these kind of things. Instead, all was filmed in the real places. So it was a bit hard because you cannot control it. So there are the days you can film, the days you have to stop, the days when the tide is too strong, and so it's not easy. And the last point was what I said before, so that there are animated fishes mixed with real environment. So, it started as a short movie idea. What it became? It became a full-length movie. This full-length movie is 8 minutes long. It's going to be 8 minutes long because it's not finished yet. And it will have 7 different races animated. Footage was already shot almost 70-80% was already shot, and all over the world it was in the well, we'll say it later where it is. And the plot leaves an open end, so if everything is going to be good and have a nice success, we can have a sequel. So there are already ideas for going on and developing the characters. What's already done? As I said, almost all footage and 5 characters modeled and rigged and with some animations, and a teaser. That's what we are going to show today at the conference. What's the story about? The story is about it starts with two characters that are an old woman with her nephew. But the real story is about this mermaid who is very young and is going to discover the sea. And discovering the sea, this mermaid encounters many friends that are other kind of fishes. And she will meet a manatee, she will meet what we call in Italian ball fish, and other ones that we see. She will meet also a shark. And meeting these friends, she will learn what happens in the sea, what are the rules for living in the sea, what are the rules for making the sea live also. So this journey of the mermaid is also not just adventures, so emotions, but also some meaning, some deeper meaning. So, the director, I have to spend some words about the director, which is Leonardo Sergiani. Since now it has been very, very nice to work with him, because he's talented a lot, and that's usually when there's a person with so much talent, this person knows it and behaves like that. Instead, he is very kind, he listens to everybody before making something. He takes in account everyone's opinion, so it has been very wonderful. Leonardo won many prizes, and we can see some of the prizes he won. It's in Italian because something was not easy to translate. So, but these are prizes that are given for underwater movies. So they are like the Oscars or the Leone di Venezia, you know, all these kind of prizes for movies. They are also for underwater movies, and they are all over the world, these kind of prizes. And he was in some professional and amateur sessions, and he won in both a lot of prizes. He has around 38 to 40 prizes. We write the most important here. You see, there are a lot. Okay, so the nice part of this movie was the best part, I think, more than 3D, was going in the places. I went just one place, but it was a wonderful experience. The places where the film was shot were the Red Sea, the Florida coast, the Mexican coast, and South Africa coast. So, beautiful places. I think there's nothing more to say about them. The equipment used. Okay, we had two high-definition cameras, but most of the things filmed were filmed with one of the two, which is a Sony HBR-Z1, and that's a really good camera. I think it's the same. I'm not sure, but I think it's the same. And for this camera, we had a special case for handling the camera and for handling a giant lens, which was a big grandangular lens, very wide. And we also had this smaller one, which is another Sony. And we had some special lights that a company that makes lights for filming undersea in the night or in the depth had a light set that was built in a special way, and that had to test it. So we had the chance to use it, and I don't know the reason, maybe era troppo caro il set di luci che non l'hanno poi prodotto. Set di luci c'è. Okay. So that was a prototype with some special features, and I think that now it's in production, maybe with some changes, with some fixes. Okay, the mermaid. The mermaid is called Crystal in the movie, and she's a Russian actress. Her name is Marina Kazankova. She's not only an actress, because for acting underwater all the time, all the scenes, and talking underwater and trying to react to invisible actors that are the fishes that we placed, digitally, you have not only to be an actor, but also be a good diver. So we had the luck to meet her because she's a champion in snorkeling. I think she has the woman's record in
underwater. Apnea.
Snorkeling without breathing. Okay, you know. Go and she made around 90 meters. 100 meters. And that's a women's record. And so we could act because otherwise it was impossible, because she had to go down and prepare in the right position, having the start of the filming, then acting, and then going back up and breathing again. So each time was a lot of time from one shot to the other, and you know, every shot has to be done 3-4 times. So very difficult, and that was the only way, having a person that was an actor and a diver. So she had to prepare for for acting, and someone had to help her. But I wasn't the only one. And okay, what happened for making the movie? We had always to go by boat to the place that we needed, and then we went in the sea and tried to have nobody around, because you know, who has been in the Red Sea knows that it's like being in the center of a city. You turn around and there are divers everywhere appearing from every corner. So filming with a wide angle camera was really difficult, because you had to have nobody around. Then we had all our conventional signs to make everything start, stop, repeat, change, all these kind of things. And for having nobody around, we had to be a small crew. So we were only 3-4 persons in the water, no more. Okay, here comes 3D. After filming and after having all these sun baths, we had to go back in front of our computers, and we had to model, rig, and animate and render. These are the races that are in the movie. I didn't put one because I didn't find I didn't remember to look for the name. That's the fishbowl. I'm sorry. And but there are a white shark, a moray, a sea turtle, a manatee, a cleaner shrimp, and a hermit crab. And if you know what they are, it's okay. If you don't know, some of them you will see, but not all, because we didn't do all of them since now. Okay, modeling. We were working with documentaries with around 1,000 hours of filming. So each fish we had to do, he said, how many hours of filming of that fish you want as a reference? So we had all the best references. And we said, for example, for the manatee, we said, we need a close-up of the eye. Okay, he gave us and high definition close-up of the eye of the manatee closing and opening. We had almost everything. As you can see, there's real footage in the background, and here is the model of the manatee, and we can't go wrong with such a reference. Maybe we can open the manatee model in Blender so we see some of the things we have done with it. We start begin something to see something. That's the rendering you saw in the background. Okay, this is the model. You see the flow. the rigging and the front view and yes, that's the rig with the and V-tail on the rester side. The model wrapped. That's the mouth. That's his model, so he knows it very well. Okay. You see, we had controls for every part of the model. Part of the fun is that. Okay, so it's strange, but it's hard. Many can make a model that seems looks simple than a complicated one. Because if you have a complicated model, when you model it, it looks almost real. If it's very simple, it's easier to look it, for it to look artificial. Because you have a few things. The model is not detailed. For example, you see the joint from the arm. Seems that we had not enough attention for the modeling. Instead, it's really that way. The manatee is really made like that. Some of the parts of this species looked a bit artificial, so we had to do like they were. Okay.
Torna alla presentazione.
Okay. Texturing is the moray, for example. We had not a very complicated texturing. We were lucky in some way because making something that's for underwater is something that's not so easy for people to check the mistakes. Okay. It was easy for our director to check the mistakes because he knew everything. So now that side is a bit different. He opens the mouth with a slide movement and you didn't do it. Okay. But for the purpose of the final movie, if there's something that doesn't fit, it's usually not a problem. And we had to change something also from reality to make it look more integrated in the sea. There's this funny thing is that filming, I will tell it later when I will talk about it, but sometimes filmed fishes in the water look like fake, really look like fake. So you have to not make them totally real, because they would look fake also, the 3D ones. So, okay, main layers were color, bumper displacement, alpha mapping, some specular ramps, and in some fishes, subsurface scattering. Nothing else. We didn't use node materials. We tried for something, but that wasn't necessary this time. Animation, as you saw before with the manatee, we had rigging that in something was easier than human rigging because we had no fingers in no fish, and we had limited facial expressions, so we didn't have to react like a human, going into the details of the mouth and how you use the eyes for meaning something, because these fishes had to look real. It's not like Finding Nemo, where fishes act like humans, but they had to look real, so their expressions were very limited. Okay, here is an example of our Blender windows during the animation. That's the fish bowl. Anybody knows if it's correct? Flow or glow? Glow. Ah, ball fish. Okay, ball fish. Perfect. That's the ball fish. And you see the environment on the background. You see the rigging with the helpers for controlling. So something was easier. We didn't have fingers and things like that. Something was harder, because when you make a fish swim, you have to make these fish swim in a real way. It has to be. You have to look at it and say, "Oh, it's real. It's going the correct way." And if you don't study these kind of things, like anatomy of fishes and their movements and fluids simulation, all these kind of things, you know how it looks real, but you are not sure how to do it. Okay, so we had many tries to understand how a fish doing a bend has some sliding or goes tight to the movement, and it wasn't easy in many things. So something was easier from human or animal, common ground animal animation, and something was really more difficult. Yeah, that's what I said. Also, the moray had a snake-like movement. And so it wasn't easy. That's something that some changes of the bones system would help a lot, because the moray is like a snake, okay? So we had one big problem. This big problem was that if you have a spine made of bones, this spine made of bones, if you make it follow a curve, it doesn't follow the curve. I mean, I would like the bones to place along the curve. Instead, they do not place around the curve, but they stay all together and they go following the curve altogether. So we had to use we started from a hint in some page in the Blender documentation that was talking about having a snake, having the small the bones for a snake, but we had to develop it because that had some limitations. So we had a very complicated rigging, having the curve. On the curve, we had a mesh made like a simple mesh, I mean, like a tape. On this tape, we had parented with three vertices and empty. We needed to parent them to three vertices because if you parent only to one vertex, you don't get the tilt of the curve. So we had the parenting to three vertices to have the tilt of the curve. And then we had each bone of our spine was parented to an empty and tracking to the next one. So we had this complicated set, but in the end, moving the tape along the curve, the tape followed the curve. The empties were placed on the tape, and the bones pointing to the targeting to the empties and parenting to the previous ones did a good job. But that's not I think that's not the best way to have it, because it's very limiting this way. And and also, if you want, for example, to have the bones following the curve, but having independence, it's, changing something, it's trouble, it's really trouble. Another big, big trouble was that the upper part of the moray bends with different timing from the body. So when the body goes, it's like having a delay from the body, but we tried to control the upper part with parenting delay, but it didn't work. It didn't work because parenting delay wasn't. You cannot give only one direction to parenting delay, but it delays in 3D. So we needed, for example, if you have this one is the moray and this is the upper part, and you have some empties to have slow parenting for making it bend, but they are slow parenting also in this direction if the moray moves. So everything goes quite in a mess with slow parenting. So the situation we had temporary was to having some bones going perpendicular and animating these bones manually to have the bending. But that's not what we wanted, because if the moray stops, we would like to have an automation that is stopping also the upper part stops slowly after. So we can see the rigging. Okay. Okay, you can see it looks like a simple rigging with the bones along the moray and all the bones controlling the upper part. But really, it's not. Yeah, you see the tape below. You know that you see that lower green, dark green tape. Okay, that's enough for the moray. We had some big troubles, and then we can see the modeling of the fishbowl. Okay, you see, we used the linked characters, so we made the changes in the character and we had the result in the scene also always updated. The fishbowl has this strange behavior that when he is in danger, it makes grow the lower part of his belly, and this is an example of artificial and real looking. I mean, makes it grow so much in reality that looks artificial. We had to make it grow less because it seemed fake. It's not working.
Oops. Oops.
Scena 4.
Mettiamo questo qua. Okay, you see how much it grows, and in real world it was growing a lot more. Giant, but rendering it was almost unbelievable. So if somebody saw it, knowing that the film had fake characters, thinks, oh, they exaggerated. So we had to do it less to make it look more real. Yes, you see here, that's growing a lot. Yeah, it was growing 50% more in reality. Okay, and after modeling and texturing and rigging, we had to make the final steps, which were rendering. Okay, we needed some features. We needed them absolutely. These features were the hair for. Other for the shrimp, but we don't have the shrimp here. Subsurface scattering for the fishbowl, motion blur obviously, micro displacement, because you look at the skin of the manatee. Without we have some renderings without a displacement. They are horrible. Okay, really horrible. and that buffer data for compositing, because we have to composite with real footage, so we needed really to have masks for depth, for boundings, and this kind of things. Blender had almost everything. What Blender was missing more was micro displacement. So what we did? We tested some renderers, and we had renderings with Pixi, and also Axis, and we tried, and we said, okay, we have found a way. Wonderful, let's go, let's use the Rib Mosaic. We made many tests, and we had some good results, but in the end, each different renderman, open source different renderman, had some troubles. For example, Axis had didn't have ray tracing and had so much long rendering time, especially with motion blur enabled. So this time wasn't we couldn't afford this time for rendering. So we had to use Pixi, and we tried with Pixi, but we had some troubles with Pixi's displacement. It had some mistakes, so the shapes showed some jagged seams, and we didn't solve it. So we tried with Gelato, NVIDIA's GPU-powered render engine, and we tried with Blender Gelato. We had also there very good results, but there were some things that didn't work good. Some of the things were that Gelato is not developed anymore. That's why it has become free. And we had some troubles with Zbuffer, because it doesn't export it easily. It exports an OpenXR with the depth information stored in the red channel. So we had to pull it out from the red channel, discovering after that depth information didn't have anti-aliasing and didn't have motion blur. So it wasn't usable, because if we composite the rendering in the footage and the fish has motion blur, and we need maybe to change the fish to a more blue color, we just change the fish and not the motion blur of the fish. That's not good. Blender internal. And Blender internal didn't have good displacement, and vector blur has some troubles when we have tight curves and the shapes are entering the frame of the rendering and going out. So it has some troubles, but what happened in the end? In the end, we made this teaser with Blender's internal rendering engine. We had really fast rendering time. We cut almost all the ray tracing features, and we tried to achieve all the best of the look just with textures and good lights. Compositing. For the compositing, we had to mix the shooting from the camera, which is HDV compressed on horizontal size, so 1440 wide, that becomes 1920. So that was stretched. Also, there was interlaced video signal. So very different from digital one. And another funny thing is that color underwater is a big problem, because you know that when you go underwater, everything is blue. Why everything is blue? Because water cuts red frequencies. So what happens that you have to film with a filter, a red filter in front of the camera. But this red filter is optimal for a specific distance. If you are shorter, things look red. If you are beyond, things look blue. So what happens? That everything that goes close to the camera and goes away changes its color continuously. So if it goes in front of you, it changes from blue to correct color to reddish color. If it goes away, it's the opposite. That was one of the main reasons for Z-buffer informations, because we had to change the colors continuously from blue to correct color to red colors. After doing all these settings and calibrations for compositing the original movies undersea and the 3D. Okay, here are some of the things that I said. We had to color correct the high definition clips because, you know, it's always washed what you get. Wash the colors. And then you have to get a filmic look with darker areas, and maybe you lose some detail, but you have more contrast. Then we had to deinterlace. We had to do chroma key for fishes that were beyond some rocks or some other fishes. Then our alpha rendered clips were mixed with the film, so we had the film and in the middle, like a sandwich, we had the 3D, and then we had some particles, we had some global color correction, and some hype with glow and other things. So that this is a simplified scheme of what was the compositing. So we have on the back we have the original background. And then we have our Moray rendered, the depth information. The depth information changes the color of the Moray according to the distance. You see in the middle it's more yellow and green in the original renderer. Instead, in the compositing it's blue, but the tail is the same color. Then we added the chroma key, and then the compositing, and then after the compositing, the total color correction and global effects. Oh, maybe before the conclusions, we see the teaser. We are talking a lot. We have seen some models, some 3D, some rigging, but we haven't seen it yet. Okay. One or two most important things to say before watching it. We had, obviously, as every worker, we were in a hurry because we had a delay in some parts. And so, what happened for the deadline for the Blender conference? It happened that the composer of the music didn't finish it in time. It wasn't his fault, because we had the sequence, the complete sequence, we gave him too late to compose something good. But we had a reference, because he lives in another town, the director in another one. We had a lot of online communication, and we had some music that we used for giving time for every scene. So we will show it with this music. This music is copyrighted, but we are not using it to sell it, and we'll change it. It's just here not to show you without music, but showing you what we had as a background music for compositing everything. The other thing is that final rendering was made around yesterday. And and the director living in another town on FTP, okay. He made compositing in a final compositing in about 4 hours. So there's something that really we don't like about this compositing, but we will show you different compositing of other tests, so you will get difference that changes a lot. Okay, so we now are going to see this teaser. The teaser is around 3 minutes long, and we didn't do many other things after the teaser, because now the movie, the director is looking for a serious producer. We had some links and contacts with Italian producers and also Russian producers, but obviously we are open and we are looking for someone. And this is the first time that we come out publicly. Everything was hidden with secret since now. Okay.
Facciamo partire. Sì. Non mi riesco a capire.
Un nuovo modo di conoscere. Di ascoltare il male.
Non conti.
No. Conterò il cuore. Viene da un mio cuore.
Un po', per favore.
L'hai vista della
con la sua
certo.
Per le sette voluta. Una.
Hai chiesto una sna.
Sirena era?
Con un segreto
del mare. Crista. Una delle tre più.
Ci manca la vanità.
Si capisca, reci del mare.
Allora pista.
E i suoi soliti amici.
E se non
ti aspetta.
Il nostro baccano. La procura cena.
C'è nessuno?
Una bella.
Cinema.
Dura.
Mare. La sirena.
Not all. Okay, obviously. Fish is worth a fish. You can. Music. You weren't here before. Okay. The music is not the final music. Because the composer didn't finish it in time. So this is copyrighted music that we use just to have the rhythm. Yeah, but it will be better, obviously. Okay, maybe I think if you want, we can watch it again, stopping at the sequences, so I can explain you something about the renderings and the features we had in each one. Okay, obviously these are real ones.
Un nuovo modo.
As I told you, something is not really what we had, but
di ascoltare.
Not fun. Correct. It's not a lot.
Ma.
C'è che deve raccontare una che vi.
Mi racconto.
Profondo il mio cuore.
Per le febbre che potessi
odiare. No. Che
male.
Che succede?
Il.
This one had is going good because it has a subsurface scattering. It worked very well. We had a lot of difficulty in making the lights look good because underwater light comes from everywhere. You try to look to get which is the direction of the sun. You look at the corals and you say, okay, the sun comes this way. You see, on the left is bright, on the right is dark. You see, this one is the opposite. What's that? So, light comes from almost everywhere. So what we ended to do? We ended to do what was lightning before global illumination and other things. We put colored lights where we thought they were looking good, and in each scene they were different. To look for the lighting of the scene, so we had here we had some yellow light coming from bottom, and the sun coming with white color, and then a blue light from many directions from above, till we got it. Okay, going to the next, the moray. Okay. Sorry. Okay, the moray, you... Oh, this screen doesn't show it a lot, but you see that the far part is blue and in front is reddish. As I said, you to mimic the different change of color filming underwater for the frequencies of the light that they are different. There's some bug in texture unwrapping. Okay, this is the manatee. It's not showing. Why? Okay.
Tutte le febbie delle Molucche.
Un po' di silenzio, per favore.
Okay. We see here what we did to achieve displacement in Blender, the only way, so five times the subdivision, and hoping to make it look good, and putting some normal mapping on it to get more detail. And it looks good now, but I have to say that the displacement looked better with micro displacement in Gelato. It was better because we could have a lot of more detail. We cannot make the mesh 10 million polygons more than it was, around 10 million, but more than to get every little detail. But it worked good. What was good was that the rendering was really, really fast. Okay, I mean, every one of the shots that lasts around 3 seconds for each fish, the final rendering in high definition was done in 1 hour for each shot. So, very good. Basically, thanks to not having ray tracing and thanks to vector motion blur. But we tried, in some scenes we had troubles with motion vector blur, made something strange, changing the direction randomly. Again, here we have, we can see, before we had some chroma key, and then we used the a reference to make the manatee. The manatee put the that part on the coral. You see. So compositing in the end was very good. We were lucky because the sea is a giant blue screen. So it was very easy. Yes. But it sticks good. We had this scene was impossible without having a fixed camera. Other ones we had movements and we had to track them.
Bella, ma è una...
Ti sei mai chiesta come parla una sirena?
Una sirena vera?
Mi chiamo Crystal.
Again, the fishbowl. This also was with fixed camera.
Sono una delle creature più belle del mare.
Ah, ci mancava solo la sirena vanitosa.
Sono noi seguire il mare. Copri i piti del mare.
Shark. Here you see, yeah, it looks very dark. It's not so dark, but you know, limited range of colors and reactors. The shark most fun thing to do was the tail that has a delay in the end. Okay, so it looks like this. And that was done with the delayed parenting. We could do that because sharks don't usually, in these shots, don't have rapid changes of directions. So we could do it. The shark also has displacement. You will see it better in the next one. Yeah, see? Okay. We have some nice displacement that gives shark more real look. Okay, here is the sea turtle. These three scenes are with free camera, so we had to track them. We tracked them with Voodoo. It worked quite good. It was without changing many parameters, but I would like to know who changes the parameters in Voodoo. Nobody understands anything about that parameters. And this one and the following two other scenes here are have a bad compositing, as I told before, because they were the ones rendered in the night. And we have another teaser with better rendering of them. So maybe we can open it and look at it.
Maybe you have like no time left, so if you want to ask. Play this and then
yes, it's finished. Okay. It was all
very much. La sirena e i suoi insoliti amici no, ti aspettano al cinema. Un mare da favore.
Thank you.
Sei solo satissimo ascoltare le voci del mare.
Credo. Quello c'è.
Aprilo con Videolan.
Finishes with Blender's particles. the sequence was longer and they were doing circles around the mermaid.
Okay. La sirena e i suoi insoliti amici ti aspettano al cinema.
Okay. We have to and final thoughts. Around. Okay. What's gone right? We didn't think to do such things. We are satisfied. We had also some feedback from somebody and it was very good. The environment and the real shooting is spectacular. That's something that really helps everything to look fantastic. What's gone wrong? We had many troubles with HDV quality. We had troubles with budget because everything since now was funded by the director. So that's why he's looking for producers. We had some limitations from Blender rendering, and we tried to do all compositing in Blender, but Sequencer didn't make us work fast, and there are some limits also on compositing. We had not enough parameters to have a perfect chroma key. Some bugs. We tried to bend the morays. Tail with soft bodies, but each time we did it, it had different behaviors with same settings, and we didn't understand why. In Linux and in Windows, it was different, we didn't understand. And then we had the storyline redesign. We don't know how to fix something, it's still more than open. That's what we would like to say. And we hope. We'll have another premiere. It's no more a premiere. We hope soon, in 1 month, in a virtual conference in Turin. We'll hope. We are not sure. because we are not in the schedule now, but that's all. And that's all. I know the time is end up, but if you have some questions. Yes?
The mermaid still is real.
The mermaid is real.
The tail is
Real. Yes. We had some problems with the mermaid because the things that are holding her. You know? Okay. It have a tape, a transparent tape, but has some specular reflections. So in some shots we see them, and we try to hide them with some tracking and some tricks, but it's not easy. So it would be really hard to make a 3D model of the tail and track it to her. It would be really very, very difficult. So it was a normal old way trick. We said, why not making her act naked? But somebody told it, it's a movie for children, and we said the children are used to see their mother naked, so it would be really bad. But that's fun. That's fun. Obviously, it's okay. Another question.
One last question, and then
yes. Okay.
Can you repeat the question? Can you repeat it? Because you didn't have a...
Yes, he said, how can we track the camera without having... You mean geometry or something easy to track, no?
Yeah, just blue walking.
Yeah. There were many different situations. We had some fixed cameras and there was no problem. There were swim cameras and there were some troubles, but we had one great advantage. The great advantage was that our fishes aren't on the ground. So if they float a bit, it's perfect. They are in the water. So our tracking hadn't to be perfect at all. But you know, if you have the corals like that, voodoo tracks them perfectly. They don't move anymore. Okay, so it was good. Maybe it tracks with strange 3D. I mean, not proportions are not correct, but the tilt and the panning they are perfect. So it's okay. Okay. Thank you very much.